JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week September the 28th until October the 2nd. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, we don't have any central bank decisions on this week's agenda, but we do have events that could attract investors' attention. On Monday, the last round of Brexit negotiations over a trade deal begins, while on Tuesday, we have the first debate between presidential candidates Donald Trump and Joe Biden. As for the data, the main release may be the US employment data for September, due to be released on Friday. Now, on Monday, there are no major economic indicators on the agenda, so focus may fall on the political landscape, as this week we have the last round of negotiations between the EU and the UK with regards to a trade deal, ahead of next month's EU summit, at which any potential accord needs to be ratified. Recently, several officials have changed their rhetoric, saying that a breakthrough is possible, with one official noting that the deal is 90% there. Thus, if we do see handshakes this week, the pound is likely to gain, while in case of no progress, it could fall back below 127 against its US counterpart. Now, on Tuesday, during the Asian morning, we get the Tokyo CPIs for September and the summary of opinions from the latest Bank of Japan meeting. With regards to the CPIs, no forecast is available for the headline rate, while the core one is anticipated to have held steady at minus 0.3% year over year. As for the summary of opinions, we will look for hints on officials' view over the Japanese economy. In the statement of the meeting, it was noted that the economy remains in a severe state, which was an upgrade compared to the previous gathering, in the statement of which it was noted that the economy was in an extremely severe state. Now, with regards to the yen, I don't expect it to react to the summary of opinions. I do believe that it will stay mostly linked to developments surrounding the broader investor morale, headlines surrounding the coronavirus, headlines surrounding the US elections, and stuff like that. During the European session, we get Germany's preliminary CPIs for September. The CPI rate is forecast to have declined to minus 0.1% year over year from 0%, while the HICP1 is expected to have stayed unchanged at minus 0.1% year over year. This could raise speculation that Eurozone's headline inflation due out on Wednesday may have stayed in negative waters as well. Now, in the US, the Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for September is coming out, and the forecast points to an increase to 89.2 from 84.8. Now, on the political front, we have the first debate between Donald Trump and Joe Biden. In general, a Trump re-election may be positive for stocks, as a Trump win would keep the 2017 corporate tax cuts in place, with the president perhaps pushing for more infrastructure spending. Biden may result in a retreat in equities, as he has called for an increase in taxes on corporations and high-income individuals. He is also expected to increase regulations on certain sectors and industries, including banks, energy, and healthcare. Having said all that, the first debate may reveal if indeed this is investors' thinking or not. In other words, we may get a first taste on how the markets may react on the election outcome. Now, on Wednesday, Asian time, we get the preliminary industrial production from Japan. We get New Zealand's ANZ business confidence index and China's official PMIs, all for the month of September. Japan's industrial production is forecast to have slowed to 1.5% month over month from 8.7%, while no forecast is available for New Zealand's ANZ confidence index. China's manufacturing PMI is anticipated to have risen fractionally to 51.2 from 51, but there is no estimate for the non-manufacturing index. And during the early EU trading, we get the UK's final GDP for the second quarter, which is expected to confirm the initial print, namely that the UK economy has contracted 20.4% quarter over quarter in the 3 months to June. German retail sales for August are also coming out, and the forecast points to a 0.4% month-over-month rebound after a 0.9% slide the month before. Now, from the Eurozone as a whole, the preliminary CPIs for September are due to be released. The headline rate is forecast to have held steady at minus 0.2% year-over-year, while no forecast is available for the core one. That said, the HICP, excluding food and energy metric, is expected to have accelerated to 1.1% year-over-year from 0.6%. Now, at the prior ECB meeting, policymakers kept monetary policy unchanged, reiterating that they stand ready to adjust all their instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards its aim in a sustained manner. Now, following the worse-than-expected PMIs for September, with the services sector slipping into contraction, another negative headline CPI print may increase speculation for additional stimulus by the ECB. However, the fact that the core HICP rate is expected to have accelerated means that the weak headline CPI rate may be the result of declines in energy and food, which may allow policymakers to wait for a while before they decide to push the easing button. They may prefer to wait and see whether the deflationary rate is something temporary or not. Now, in any case, if the headline CPI comes into negative waters and the core HICP rate accelerates by less than expected or even declines, this would increase drastically speculation with regards to further stimulus by the ECB, perhaps as early as at the upcoming gathering, and this could hurt the euro. But if the forecasts are met, I don't expect any major market reaction. Later, from the US, we get the ADP employment report for September. The forecast suggests that the private sector has gained 605,000 jobs after adding 428,000 in August. This may raise speculation that the NFPs due out on Friday may come slightly below their own forecast, which is at 875,000. That said, we repeat for the upteenth time that the ADP number is far from a reliable predictor for the NFP print. Even last month, when the ADP revealed 428,000 additional jobs, the NFP came in at 1.027 million. The final GDP for the second quarter and pending home sales for August are also coming out. The final US GDP is expected to confirm its second estimate, while pending home sales are forecast to have slowed to 3.2% month over month from 5.9%. Now, from Canada, we get the monthly GDP for July, which is expected to reveal a slowdown to 3% month over month from 6.5%. However, this would still be a historically strong monthly rate, which combined with the little changed CPIs for the month of August is very likely to allow Bank of Canada policymakers to sit comfortably to the sidelines for a while more. At their latest meeting, they kept policy unchanged, reiterating that they stand ready to adjust their programs if market conditions change. So having all that in mind, I don't believe that a slowdown to 3% will hurt the loonie. Now on Thursday, Chinese markets will be closed due to the Mid-Autumn Festival. In Japan, the Tankan survey for the third quarter is due to be released, with both the large manufacturers and non-manufacturers indices expected to have risen to minus 23 and minus 9 from minus 34 and minus 17, respectively. Later in the day, we get the final manufacturing PMIs for September from the Eurozone, the UK, and the US. As it is the case most of the times, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates, so I don't believe that they will result in any market reaction. From the US, we also get the ISM manufacturing index for the month, which is expected to have inched up to 56.2 from 56, as well as the personal income and spending for August. Personal income is forecast to have fallen 2.2% after rising 0.4% in July, while spending is anticipated to have slowed to 0.7% month over month from 1.9%. The core PCE index for August is also coming out and is expected to have ticked up to 1.4 from 1.3. Now, finally, on Friday, the main event on the agenda is the official US employment report for September. NFPs are forecast to have increased by 875K, which is less than August's 1.371 million, but it's still a solid number, which is consistent with further improvement in the labor market. The unemployment rate is expected to have declined more to 8.2% from 8.4%, while average hourly earnings are forecast to have accelerated somewhat to 4.8% year over year from 4.7%. At its most recent meeting, the FOMC kept its policy unchanged, but changed its inflation language, noting that they will aim to achieve inflation moderately above 2% for some time, so that inflation averages 2% over time. With regards to the new economic projections, officials revised up their GDP and inflation forecasts and downgraded the unemployment rate once, while the new dot plot suggested that interest rates are likely to stay at present levels at least through 2023. That said, looking at the details, we see that one member was in favor of a hike in 2022 and foresaw rates higher in 2023. Combined with the inflation forecast of 2023, which is at 2%, this shows that some members may not be willing to tolerate inflation above target for long, as pointed in the decision statement. Thus, and this unemployment report on Friday, although it would be a sign that the economic recovery continues, may raise speculation that interest rates in the US may rise somewhat faster than previously anticipated. Something like that may prove positive for the US dollar, but negative for equities. Equity investors may prefer extra loose monetary policy for longer, as this means cheap loans for companies. Now, as for the rest of Friday's events, during the Asian session, Japan's employment data and Australia's retail sales, both for August, are coming out. Chinese markets will stay closed in celebration of the National Day, while later in the day in the US, apart from the official employment data, we also get factory orders for August and the final University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for September. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. Now, if you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time. At this point, I will ask if there are any questions with regards to this week's events. I will leave you a few seconds to write your questions if there are any. So we don't have any questions, so goodbye. Have a great day and a great week. Thank you very much.
JFT, just fair and direct.